Good morning, children. Hope all of you are safe at home. So today, before starting the topic, I would like to give a brief introduction on the today's topic. So like when we go to a park, we observe different sort of flowers, leaves. We can see various insects busy in sustaining their lives. So did you ever think how come these living organisms are able to sustain, or how come they are able to respond to the external factors, or how they are able to identify the hunger and thirst? Well, the answer for all these questions are discussed in today's topic. So, today we are going to start a new topic, control and coordination. So, before starting the chapter, I would like to introduce a few key terms involved in this chapter. So, let's go in a sequence. First one is stimuli. So, let's see what is stimuli. The changes in the environment in which living organisms respond are called stimuli. So examples are heat, cold, sound, smell, taste, touch, pressure, gravity, water, etc. So the living organisms respond to stimuli in the form of body movements. So did you understand now? So stimuli, it is nothing but the changes in the environment to which living organisms respond. It is called as stimuli. It can be of anything like temperature, or it can be sound, or it can be smell, everything. Next. So next, let's see what is coordination. So coordination, for a proper response to a stimulus, many organs in the body should work together. The working together of various organs in an organ system to produce a proper response to a stimulus is called as coordination. So whenever an organism is responding to a stimulus, the various organs present in an organism starts working together in responding to that particular stimuli, and this is called as coordination. So in animals, control and coordination is done by the nervous system and the endocrine system. So later on we'll be discussing what is nervous system and endocrine system. So next, in plants, control and coordination is done by chemical substances called as plant hormones or phytohormones. This will be discussed later. So next key term is receptors. Receptors are the sense organs which receive the stimuli and pass the message to the brain or spinal cord through the sensory nerves. So I'll discuss what are sensory nerves later on. So let's see the examples of receptors. Receptors are of various types. The first one is photoreceptors, which are present in the eyes to detect the light. Phonoreceptors in the ears to detect sound. Olfactory receptors in the nose to detect smell. Gustatory receptors in the tongue to detect taste. Tangoreceptors in the skin to detect the touch. So next important key term is effectors. So effectors are the muscles and glands which respond to the information from the brain and spinal cord through the motor nerves. And next is sensory nerves. Sensory nerves are the nerves which carry information from the receptors, that is the sense organs, to the brain and the spinal cord. And next one is motor nerves. These are the nerves which carry information from the brain and spinal cord to the effectors, that is the muscles and glands. So these are the key terms that are being involved in this chapter. Without a proper knowledge on these key terms, you will not understand further chapter. Now let's go in detail about the chapter. So now let's talk about the parts of our nervous system. The human nervous system consists of central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. As I told you, human beings are controlled and coordinated by the nervous system and the endocrine system. You know why? It is because humans are multicellular organisms. Unlike plants, these are not simple organisms, and thus they require a group of organs and organ systems that should be involved to control and coordinate the entire body. And so the central nervous system, it is consisting of brain and spinal cord. The peripheral nervous system consists of cranial nerves arising from the brain and spinal nerves arising from the spinal cord. So what can be the function of central nervous system? So central nervous system function is, it gathers the information from all the body parts and it is sending the information via the sensory nerves to the brain and the spinal cord. The peripheral nervous system function is to send the information that is interpreted by the brain to all parts of the body or to the effectors. So this is the external view of brain and spinal cord. So these are the nerves involved in a human body. You can see cranial nerves that is going from the brain to your eyes, mouth, ears and other parts of your head. Central nerves that are in your brain and spinal cord. And next you can see peripheral nerves going from your spinal cord to your arms, hands, legs and feet. And you can see here autonomic nerves that is going from your spine to lower part of your body. That is the stomach. So far I was speaking about nervous system. So what is this nervous system? What it is made of? Nervous system, it is made up of a network or a group of cells called as nerve cells, and it is also called as neuron. So let's see what is this neuron. So neuron is a structural and functional unit of nervous system. And remember, this is the longest cell in the human body, which is varying in a length of 90 to 100 centimeters. So coming to the structure of this neuron, this has a cell body called as cyton. This cyton consists of a nucleus which is placed centrally and it is surrounded by cytoplasm. And this cyton is having several branch-like structures called the dendrites. Also, this cytoplasm is being terminated to a long nerve fiber called axon, which is covered by a protective covering called the myelin sheath. So the junction between the two neurons is called as synapse. So as you look at the diagram, you'll understand the structure in detail. So messages from the nerve cell in the form of chemical and electric signals called as nerve impulse. The dendrites receive the information and starts a chemical reaction which produce electric impulse, and this is passed through the axon. So this is the typical structure of neuron. So here you can see the cell body which is having a central nucleus, and you can see a green color round like thing. This is called as nucleus. This is surrounded by fluid like thing that is called the cytoplasm. And here you can see the cytoplasm is having several branches called the dendrites. And here this is the site at which receptors are present. And so here you can see the cell body is being it is giving rise to a long nerve fiber that is called as axon. And this axon is covered by a protective sheath called the myelin sheath. And this axon is further terminated into endings called as nerve endings, or it is also called as axon terminal. So this is actually a single, this is actually a single neuron. So the information is being carried from one neuron to the other neuron, and the gap between two neurons is called as synapse. So far we have discussed about the structure of neuron. Let's see how message is being transferred from one neuron to the other neuron via the synapse. Yes. So now, the transmission of messages through neurons. So here, as I told you, this is the transmission of messages through the neurons. Now, the receptors are present on the dendrites. And so what happens is whenever they are responding to a particular stimulus, here, as the receptors are sensitizing to the stimuli, what happens is they generate an electric impulse, and this electric impulse is being carried into the cytoplasm, and then it is being carried into the axon, and then to the axon endings. So what happens is, after reaching the axon endings, here there sets a chemical reaction in which certain neurotransmitters, listen properly, neurotransmitters called as acetylcholine. So these chemical substances are released due to a chemical reaction at the nerve ending. And so what happens is, these chemicals triggers the dendrites of the other nerve cell. And so what happens is, these chemicals on sensitizing the receptors on the next nerve cell, there sets a chemical reaction and electric impulse is generated and this process goes on. Okay, so this is how message is being transmitted from the dendrite of a presynaptic cell to a postsynaptic cell. So what is a presynaptic cell? Here, presynaptic cell is the information that is present at the nerve ending, and the postsynaptic cell is the dendritic tip of the. So hope you understood the transmission of a nerve impulse between two neurons. And next, coming to a reflex action, this is somewhat, not somewhat, it is totally related to the transmission of nerve impulse. So let's see what is reflex action. Reflex action is a sudden, unconscious and involuntary response of the effectors to a stimulus. See, for example, like when we touch a hot pan, we immediately move our hand. This is nothing but reflex action. Here, touching the hot pan is the stimuli. Here the hot pan is the stimuli, and moving the hand from the hot pan is the reaction. And so this pathway, this is called as a reflex action. So in this reflex action, the nerves in the skin, that is the receptor, detects the heat and passes the message through the sensory nerves to the spinal cord. Then the information passes through the motor nerves. Then it is being carried to the muscles of the hand and we withdraw our hand. This part you'll be understanding after looking at the diagram. So this is the pathway for a reflex action. So here you can see the structure of a spinal cord, and here this butterfly like structure is called the, this is the cross section of spinal cord, and this is the receptor. So what is happening is, when you are pricking your finger with a pin, so immediately what happens is, the receptors present on the finger sets up a chemical reaction, and thereby an electric impulse is generated, and this is being carried by the sensory neuron and it is sent to the spinal cord. And there you have an association area there, in which the interneuron, the relay neuron, interprets the information and sends the information to the effector via the motor nerve. And so there the effectors, since the muscles are made up of special contractile filaments, they start contracting once they get the information from the spinal cord. And thereby, once you prick your hand with a pin, so immediately you will sensitize the pain, and then immediately you will move your hand. It is because of the contraction of special filaments present in the muscles. And later on, the muscles relaxes and the hand comes to its original position. And so this is the pathway for a reflex action. And so next is a reflex arc. This is a concept that is related to reflex action. So the pathway of a reflex action is called as reflex arc. So as I told you, how the response is being created. So in a reflex arc, the stimulus is received by the receptors and it passes through the sensory nerves to its spinal cord. From the spinal cord, the information passes through the motor nerves to the effectors for the response. So this is the reflex arc. Here you can see the stimulus that is taken up by the receptor. This impulse that is being created at the receptor is carried by the sensory neuron. There it goes to the association neuron, and this interprets the information, and it is being carried by the motor neuron and then to the effector, and thus creates a response. And so this total pathway is called as reflex arc. So here you might be confused, the afferent and efferent fibers. So afferent fibers are nothing but sensory neurons, and efferent fibers are nothing but motor neurons. And next comes to your divisions of nervous system, human brain. So this is the view of human brain. So the brain is the main coordinating center in the human body. It is protected by the cranium. So you can say it is covered by three membranes called meninges, filled with a fluid called cerebrospinal fluid, which protects the brain from shocks. So it is covered by three membranes called meninges, and the fluid present in the meninges is called as cerebrospinal fluid, which prevents the brain from getting shocks. The brain is divided into three main parts, that is forebrain, midbrain and midbrain. So let's see in brief what are the functions of forebrain, midbrain and midbrain. So forebrain, it consists of cerebrum, olfactory lobes and hypothalamus. Cerebrum, it is the thinking part of the brain. It controls voluntary actions. It controls touch, hearing, taste, sight, mental activities like thinking, learning, memory, emotions, etc. And this cerebrum is also having separate areas of association called the sensory areas, association areas and motor areas. So as I told you before, sensory areas receive sensory impulses from various receptors in the skin, muscles, eyes, ears, nose. Association areas, it interprets the information that is brought by the sensory nerves. So motor areas, it sends impulses from the brain to muscles, glands, and cause movement in voluntary muscles. So next is olfactory lobes. A pair, these are the pair of club-shaped bodies responsible for detecting smell. Hypothalamus, and this controls body temperature, urge of eating, drinking, etc. So here there is nothing to explain in detail, because all the parts of the brain are having specific functions where you need to memorize all of them. So next is midbrain, controls involuntary actions and reflex movements of head, neck, eyes, etc. In brain, it consists of three parts, cerebellum, pons and medulla. Let's see the functions. Cerebellum controls body movements, balance and posture. Pons, it controls respiration. Medulla controls heartbeat, blood pressure, swallowing, coughing, sneezing and vomiting. So here comes last topic in nervous system, that is the spinal cord. Spinal cord starts from the brain and extends through the vertebral column. So what is this vertebral column? This vertebral column, it is nothing but you can say backbone, in which the spinal cord is protected. So it has 31 pairs of spinal nerves, and this spinal cord, it carries the messages to and from the brain. Also, spinal cord is very, very important in controlling the reflex actions. So this is the external view of spinal cord. So here you can see the nerves that is being involved in your spinal cord. So cervical nerves, thoracic nerves, lumbar nerves, sacral nerves and coccygeal nerves. These are some of the nerves, spinal nerves. So that's it for today's class, and you'll be having a worksheet that is being attached to the presentation, and so solve the worksheet and we'll be discussing the key in the next class.